Let me give you a little brief about the lecture and give you a few words about the speaker. See, the lecture actually, what Dr. Damodaran had proposed is what I'm going to read out to you. The lecture will look at the relationship between music and politics through the tradition of the Indian People's Theatre Association, IPTA, as an important example of the unfolding of a radical impulse in the arts, something which is of extreme contemporary relevance today, the artist as the natural rebel, and using the radical impulse as a concept to denote a process of questioning and reorganizing the aesthetic order. It will demonstrate how a tradition such as that of IPTA used music to raise and respond to critical political questions of the time. Her talk will discuss the relevance of some of the experiences of music making in the IPTA tradition and the debates that took place for contemporary times. A word about the speaker. Dr. Sumangala Damodaran is an economist who is working in the School of Development Studies at the Ambedkar University, Delhi, which is AUD. She has been involved with the cultural protest movement in Delhi from the early 1980s onwards and was part of a protest song group called Parcham from the early 80s to the early 90s in Delhi. Over this period and later as well, she has worked with Safdar Hashmi and his street theatre group Jannatya Manch, as well as with theatre personalities like Habib Tanveer and Prasanna. She has also in recent years been involved with research and teaching in popular music studies and is involved with the setting up of the School of Culture and Creative Expressions at AUD in this capacity. Beginning from an independent research fellowship in Sarai, Center for Studies in Development Societies, a well-known educational outfit there, research outfit, New Delhi, she has been involved in research and documentation of a forgotten musical tradition, that of IPTA from the 1940s and 50s. She has lectured on the subject of the school at the School of Arts and Aesthetics at JNU in New Delhi, various colleges in Delhi University, and at the Center for India Studies in Africa, University of Witwatersrand, South Africa, and has also written a book based on the research entitled, The Radical Impulse, Music in the Tradition of the Indian People's Theatre Association. She has also performed from this repertoire extensively in different parts of the country.
It is indeed a great privilege and honor to be asked to give this year's annual Ashok Da Ranade Memorial Lecture. It's something that I never imagined would happen. So I'd like to thank profusely the Ashok Da Ranade Memorial Trust, Anjum Rajabali, Shubha Mudgalji, Anish Pradhanji, and all the others who have been involved in organizing today's seminar as well as this particular lecture. I'm going to start by telling some stories. A young woman, Swatantrata, stands in front of a microphone in front of an audience of about 85,000 peasants in Lahore sometime in the early 1940s. She sings a heer, which has been written by Sheila Bhatia, who was a prominent theatre person in Lahore by then. This is a heer that was written to talk to the peasants in Punjab about what was happening to their brothers in Bengal, far away Bengal, where the Bengal famine had broken out and about 3 million people reportedly died in the famine. The lyrics of the heer were as follows. To whom can I tell my sad story? Who can cure me of my malady? I have lost my home and family. Who can answer my innumerable questions? This is how it went. Kinu phool dasa dukh dard saiyo mera rog tala ilaaj dise. साई कनु छुटे मैं थो क्यों सवाल है बिना जवाब दिसे The gathering had been organized by the All India Kisan Sabha that worked closely with the Communist Party of India to generate awareness about the devastating Bengal famine. The program on the said day consisted of songs and speeches by communist and peasant leaders, many of whom were underground and appeared in public only briefly during the rally. Swatantrata's powerful singing was riveting and served a purpose. It drew attention away from the activity going on backstage. The arrival and departure of underground speakers who ran the risk of being arrested and who would become visible only when they were ready to make a speech. Many decades later, Swatantrata recalled to me how the heat had reduced large numbers in the audience to tears. In fact, some of the peasants, thinking she had sung her own story, met her in the streets of Lahore the next day and offered her food and shelter. Sheila Bhatia, who later moved to Delhi and became a prominent theater person, became well known for using the many forms of the heer in her theater productions. Reba Roy Chaudhary, a well-known singer and actress from Bengal, related a story from the early 1940s in an interview in January 2007 to me. The story went as follows. The dance drama Bhuka Bengal, the play Antim Abhilasha, and several songs like Purab Desh Mein Duggi Baje, Suno Hind Ke Rehne Walon, Hoi 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 Japanoi, gave concrete shape to the voice of Bengal squad. We toured Gujarat and Maharashtra extensively by train. We did shows in Ahmedabad, Surat, Baroda, Anand, Nadiad and Godhra in Gujarat, and Pune, Aurangabad, Jalgaon, Sholapur and Kolhapur in Maharashtra. Bengal's famine had shaken up all of India. We would alight at stations every 80 to 90 miles and start performing. We were fired by strong principles, rigor and discipline, and the combination of our ordinary appearance and excellent performance would mesmerize audiences. It is difficult to describe in how many ways audiences would help and appreciate us. Each of us would travel with a small suitcase and hold on. Often we would spend the whole night on railway platforms and travel from one place to another during the day. We would carry bed sheets and brooms with us, sweep the platform, spread the sheets out and sleep on the platform. Once we were returning from a show in Gujarat's Godhra. The train arrived at Godhra station where we were waiting. We knew that it wouldn't halt for more than a minute. We hurried and jumped onto the train with all our belongings. Many minutes passed and we realized that the train had still not moved. After more than 20 minutes, when the train started moving, we leaned out of the windows and saw a smiling gangman waving a yellow sign and shouting out, Bhuka Bengal, Bhuka Bengal. Surely the gangman and his colleagues had watched our performance. We realized he was postponing our departure. By delaying our train, a whole group of railway workers were acknowledging and expressing appreciation of our previous evening show in an agricultural area close to Godhra. As she spoke, she expressed deep anguish about the genocide that had taken place after a violent incident in Godhra in Gujarat in 2002. The next story is about a love song that a peasant girl sings to a green parakeet. This love song is also a protest song. My dear green parakeet, my beloved parakeet, will you come in the afternoon to my banana grove, my love? Will you come and sing in the dancing fields? Will you come and sing a song that tickles the sickle I hold in my hand? It goes like this. பச்சப்பனந்தத்தி புன்னார பூமுத்தி பூநெல்லின் பூங்கரளே உச்சைக்கு நீ என்னை கொச்சு வாழத்தோப்பில் ஒன்னுவா பொன்னழகே பச்சப்பனந்தத்தே. மேதினி, a young worker active in the trade union movement in Alappi district in Kerala, came to be known as Pachapanandatha or Green Parakeet, as she used to sing this song, which became very popular in trade union gatherings and popular struggles in the 1940s. For one of the trade union meetings, Medini's singing was advertised through handbills that announced that she would be singing with a microphone, a new acquisition by the union. The word that was used for microphone by the union was Uchabhashini, which literally meant she who can speak loudly, with the handbill announcing the highlight of the evening as Mediniyum Uchabhashiniyum. When she finished her performance and once the meeting was over, an old man who had travelled from afar came over to Medini and asked her why her sister did not perform with her. He had assumed that Uchabhashini was her sister's name and that she would be performing with her. The songs mentioned here and hundreds of others were written and composed between 1940 and 1960, 2 out of 3 crucial decades from the 1930s that marked a transitionary period from colonialism to independence in Indian history. Composed and performed by the tradition of the Indian People's Theatre Association, a cultural organization aligned with the left political movement that was formally established in 1943, these songs, along with hundreds of other songs written and performed in different parts of the country during this period, played a crucial role in articulating the role of culture and specifically music in and as politics in the country. The IPTA came into existence when the left-wing strand of the political movement for national liberation under the leadership of the CPI had taken a position that contrasted it from the mainstream nationalist movement. The gathering momentum towards independence needed to be accelerated according to the understanding of the CPI, but within an understanding of class exploitation in India and also recognizing the dangers from fascism and the need to arrest its growth. The setting up of the IPTA and other such organizations was a response to a perceived need for new aesthetic forms that represented the people while distinguishing themselves from the cultural traditions of the mainstream nationalist movement on the one hand and commercial theatre on the other. Across the country, a large number of the best known artists of the time became part of the IPTA quite spontaneously, attempting to produce alternative aesthetic creations across diverse media. Regional and provincial branches of the IPTA were formed, all engaged in the crafting of this alternative aesthetic. In some states, such as Andhra and Kerala, other political cultural organizations, such as the Kerala People's Arts Club, KPAC, and the Praja Natya Mandali, PNM, were formed, which aligned themselves with the IPTA. Large squads consisting of dancers, musicians, actors, artists, and photographers responded in diverse ways to political issues and events. The forms ranging from plays to dance dramas to songs to dances to storytelling and much more. I refer to this set of organizations as the IPTA tradition, including the IPTA itself in its national and regional versions, as well as various others like the PNM or the KPAC that aligned themselves with the IPTA. Now, music was a very important aspect of the IPTA's work. There is some work on the theatre tradition of the IPTA, but its musical tradition remained largely undocumented in any systematic manner. Though many of the songs created and popularized by the IPTA continue to be popular and are sung in different parts of the country even today, a substantial number have also been forgotten, except in the recollections of people who were involved with the IPTA. Up to the period of the 60s or so, many of who have also passed on. A tradition such as the IPTAs can be understood as part of a radical impulse. A term that I am using to describe the interplay of considerations that went into the crafting of a radical left-wing aesthetic in the first half of the 20th century in different parts of the world and which informed the Indian experience substantially. The radical impulse, in order to respond to and represent the times through aesthetic means, meant that the boundaries of artistic expression were consciously interrogated and pushed towards bringing out multiple interpretations of the idea of the radical. While various elements of what might constitute a radical aesthetic can be found over the ages, arising in response to social and political movements of different sorts, the conscious organization of such ideas into organized artistic or cultural movements can be seen from the beginning of the 20th century, reflecting the particular historical conjuncture that the early 20th century presented. The breaking out of the First World War and the Great Depression of the late 1920s and 30s, signaling a deep crisis in capitalism. The success of the Bolshevik Revolution and growing hopes from socialism. The growth of working class movements and of emancipatory socialist consciousness in different parts of the world. The radicalization of nationalist ideas in colonized countries and of the intelligentsia in different parts of the world. What I'm calling the radical impulse consisted of three elements. The idea of the people as legitimate subjects of art and of history. The critical engagement with the terrain of the nation. The urgency of the project for freedom and further than that of emancipation and social transformation. Through these three different aspects of the radical impulse, there was a conceptualization of an alternative nationalism and a unique and unprecedented internationalism, both of which were departures from mainstream nationalist positions and which consisted in going beyond freedom and towards substantial emancipation. It was also rooted in the need to establish the idea of the people or the ordinary person as a legitimate subject of history and art, the ordinary person as a critical and legitimate protagonist. The radical impulse created sweeping changes in the world of artistic expression, which shaped anti-colonial movements, post-colonial cultural dispensations, and critiques of such dispensations as well. It left a distinct mark on the mass media and on everyday forms of artistic expression. Now, how did these different aspects play out in music? How do you produce music that is national, that is about and from the people, and is also about a radical transformatory project? How were these questions being addressed in different parts of the country? I'll first talk about the Bombay Central Squad of the IPTA that, according to me, embodied the artistic quest for a national culture from a left-wing point of view more than in the regional formations. This unfolded between 1944 and 1947 through the years of the Bengal famine, the Second World War, and independence. The Central Squad came into existence at the behest of P.C. Joshi, the General Secretary of the CPI, in July 1944, with the staging of dancer-choreographer Shanti Bardhan's dance drama, Hoda. In the first phase, Binoy Roy, Usha Dutt, Prem Dhawan, Sachin Shankar, Dina and Shanta Gandhi, Rekha Jain, Leela Sayed, these were some of the people who were the prominent members of the squad, brought to Bombay by P.C. Joshi. At a later stage, Narendra Sharma, Gul Jhaveri, Salil Chaudhary, Jyotirindra Moitra, Ravi Shankar, Ali Akbar Khan and Annapurna Devi joined the squad, as did the Bombay-based worker trio, Annabhav Sathe, Amar Sheikh and Gavankar. The IPTA produced six ballets between 1944 and 1946, Spirit of India, India Immortal being two key examples. These dance dramas, as the names suggest, attempted to present a national vision through bringing together, synthesizing and presenting forms from different parts of the country and through them conveying political messages. In music, apart from the music that was composed for the dance dramas relating to various dance forms that were used, the already prevalent nationalist idiom in music was explored as well, as in some of the songs composed by Ravi Shankar. Jyotirindra Moitra, a classically trained musician, wrote, "The grim shadow of the Great Famine loomed over the whole of Bengal, particularly the city of Calcutta. It became impossible to shut oneself up indoors. Leaving behind stimulating conversations and rehearsals of plays, we came out into the streets. Everywhere it was the same. Hundreds of thousands of skeletons wailing, 'Fan thou, fan thou, give us rice starch.' Uprooting themselves from the village, compelled by pangs of hunger, the provendering Kisan and the Jagadhatri had come to the city but dared not ask for even a couple of morsels of cooked rice. They begged for rice water. What an insult to humanity. One day I saw a woman lying dead on the street. Her innocent, hungry child pulled in vain at her nipples and wept spasmodically. The massive blow this scene struck me shook my very being. I screamed, 'No, no, no.' As I ran with unsteady steps, I muttered to myself, 'We won't allow people to die. We will resist it.' That was the beginning. I do not remember whose house it was that I went to and sat with the harmonium, from whom I borrowed paper and pen to write. That thus began the composition of Navojivo Nirgan, Songs of a New Life." Now, this was a multi-part, very long composition that was created by Jyotirindra Moitra. Rekha Jain, one of the main performers in the squad, wrote about the creative process involved in producing the ballets. 1943, the country was still under foreign rule. After the mass uprisings of 1946, the terrible repressive measures of the British, the Japanese bombardment of Bengal, and above all, the unprecedented famine of Bengal, all these had rocked our very foundations. It was then that, for the purpose of collecting funds for the famine, the party decided to send a troop to Bombay. Eventually, our troop raised a lot of funds by performing in Gujarat, Bombay, and in Maharashtra. By a strange coincidence, those days, the famous Uday Shankar group was being dismantled, and many of its talented members were in search of fruitful work. In the beginning, Abani Dasgupta gave us music lessons. Later on, Pandit Ravi Shankar came as music director. Abani Da was very particular about his tabla and started his practice sessions at 4 in the morning. Rabu Da, that is Pandit Ravi Shankar, could be heard practicing his sitar till late in the night. Even today, I can visualize him doing that on a moonlit night in the veranda. Thus, some of us practiced singing and others dancing. Sachin Shankar gave us intensive lessons in the Manipuri style to perfect our waist movements. Once I sang a Braj Bhasha song and Shanti Da, Shanti Bardhan, composed a Lambadi song on it, a Lambadi dance on it. This song proceeded in a slow tempo, but required by the climactic conclusion a fast tempo tune. For this, he tried many songs and ultimately selected a Rajasthani tune. This improvisation lent great variety to that dance piece, and the concluding portion became very effective due to it. It appears that the Central Squad was an incubator for artistic expression of a kind never tried before in India, with elements drawn from extremely varied backgrounds and traditions. The traditions that were represented ranged from the trained and sophisticated classical forms represented by Ravi Shankar, Ali Akbar Khan and Jyotirindra Moitra to the rustic and often bawdy lavanis and tamashas of Annabhav Sathe and the povadas of Amar Sheikh. There were Bengalis from Bengal and Assam, Gujaratis from Gujarat and Bombay, Purabiya dialect speakers from Bihar, Malayalis, Telugu speakers and Punjabis in the group. Ravi Shankar, for example, composed Jaga Desh Hamara, which may be considered a song in the typical mainstream nationalist idiom. It can be categorized as a classical music based song, which was reasonably within the nationalist music tradition, which was reasonably well established as a genre by the first couple of decades of the 20th century. Its hallmark being its upbeat and heroic quality, both in terms of its lyrics and the structure and orchestration of tunes. It is a group song sung at a high tempo, accompanied by several instruments, including Ravi Shankar's own sitar, violins and the bugle. The lyrics of the first verse clearly demonstrating the song text markers of typical nationalist music and the IPTA's engagement with that idiom became quite popular. These markers are the references to the country waking up, to still waters turning into vibrant rivers, to millions of freedom fighters emerging with swords in their hands to fight for freedom and other similar heroic acts. This is the kind of idiom that is being used over here. Ravi Shankar's music often used classical forms such as the thumri or compositions with complex phrases and needed to be rendered by large trained choruses that could negotiate the taans and murkis easily. For him, rigor and complexity in composition, orchestration and rendering drawn from the classical tradition was a fundamental aspect of music making, irrespective of the purpose. His response to a radical call for participation to artists for a new cultural awakening, symbolized by the IPTA, was through exploration of his own craft with all its characteristics. In the same idiom, what I'm calling the nationalist idiom, Amar Sheikh composed Janani Janmabhoomi, and Iqbal's Sari Jahan Se Acha Hindostan Hamara was set to tune by Ravi Shankar. These songs were openly mobilizational, exhorting people to rise up against colonialism and oppression, and they referred to the country as a whole, not particular regions or nationalities. Sare Jahan Se Acha, in fact, and the fact of its tune being composed and performed by the IPTA was a little known fact later in India, especially after the communists were accused of being anti-national as a result of their not openly participating in the Quit India movement of 1942. At the same time, the nation meant the freedom struggle and the conditions of ordinary people. Ravi Shankar himself composed the music for Dharti Ke Lal, a film that was produced by the IPTA and directed by K.A. Abbas, with Balraj Sahni, Tripti Mitra, Damayanti Sahni and others acting in it. Imagining the nation thus meant talking about the conditions of ordinary people and in fact anticipating and also critiquing political dispensations after independence. This constituting an alternative nationalism from below and expressing it through music. A powerful description of the conditions of ordinary people during the Bengal famine came from Jyotirindra Moitra, what I've mentioned earlier, who composed Navojivaner Gaan. Prem Dhawan, a songwriter-singer from Punjab who was living in Bombay at the time, wrote an exuberant song, Jhoom Jhoom Ke Nacho Aaj Gao Khushi Ke Geet, which is as follows. Jhoom Jhoom Ke Nacho Aaj Gao Khushi Ke Geet Jhoot Ki Aakhir Har Hui Sach Ki Aakhir Jeet. The song's last verse, representing the hope that freedom would bring an end to hunger and unemployment, a hope that national liberation would bring forth a socialist future, sounds like this. Aaj se in sundar kheto mein bhook na ugne paaye, factoryon mein mandraaye na bekari ke saaye, desh ka ye dhan daulate hai sari qaum ki poonji aaj kisi ke aage koi daman na phailaye re jhoom jhoom ke nacho aaj gao khushi ke geet. So this was the engagement with the idea of the national. An important facet of the alternative imagining of the nation was an exploration of indigenous music traditions. Varied uses of the folk idiom saw different emphasis in different parts of the country. There were those musicians like Paresh Dhar, Himangu Biswas, Nibaran Pandit in Bengal, Vishnu Prasad Rabha in Assam, and several musicians of the Prajanatya Mandali in Andhra who consciously focused on rediscovering, reclaiming and representing indigenous or more commonly folk musical traditions, many of which were getting lost or being overshadowed by modern urban-based formats. What was common to all of them was a belief that colonialism and modernity had caused the music of ordinary people to either become insignificant in public performance or to get limited to a museum display kind of performance. Documenting them, reclaiming them on behalf of the people, and performing them in ways that would allow for a depiction of ordinary people's lives was essential and thus constituted the basis for works by this set of musicians. In other words, they were being a phonograph, as the Chinese songwriter Guo Moro urged in the 1920s. Now, this was a slogan that Guo Moro gave in China in the 1920s. Another category of indigenous songs were satirical, theatrical, and simple in terms of tunes, involved those that came from traditions of singing praise and depicting glory, mostly of Hindu gods, like the Kirtan, or imagined dialogues between mythological characters, often involving discourses about good and bad deeds, or were laments about calamities and times gone bad. Often, it was only the tune or the form which would be retained, and lyrics would be more obviously political. I'm going to play a song which became very famous in Bengal, called Mountbatten Mangal Kavya by Himango Biswas, in praise of Mountbatten. Raghupati Raghava Mountbatten, Tata Birla Tero Naam, or Jai Vallabh Gopal Raja Ram. The significance of this sort of satirical form taken from indigenous singing traditions lay in their ability to accommodate verbal content flexibly and being able to connect to audiences quickly. This kind of protest song is used a lot in street theatre and continues to be part of the repertoire of groups attempting to convey a political message. There were those who went still further and used the simplicity and directness of the folk idiom, both in form and content, to express something completely modern and possibly displaced from the original. In Kerala, for example, activists of the KPAC decided to mold folk tunes and craft a new folk idiom that used simple lyrics and lilting tunes that were soon accepted as the voice of the people. The KPAC's music was created out of intense discussions among activists of people's music. The debate was about how best to depict the conditions, hopes, and aspirations of the Malayali people. That is, how a Malayala Tanima or Malayaliness could be expressed. This new idiom consciously worked with the structure of folk music by introducing greater melodic content, as it was felt that the Malayalam folk tradition consisted of forms that were monotonous and repetitive, and that a message to change the world needed to be packaged within a new, more appealing aesthetic. The new folk idiom that got crafted in the definition of this identity needed to be both simple enough to express the feelings of the common people and at the same time expressive enough to convey a range of emotions. The Kerala song tradition, therefore, used fewer authentic and traditional songs in their protest song repertoire. As far as the lyrics were concerned, there was greater emphasis on colloquial usages while consciously eschewing anything that might sound like sloganeering. So the song that I mentioned earlier about the green parakeet, Pacha Panantata, is a good example of this. These songs typically talked about the lives of peasants and their families and did not directly refer to class relations or exploitation, except through symbolism. such as references to the sickle-shaped moon that attracts a peasant girl. The love motif, invoking the pure love between ordinary people, became a hallmark of KPAC songs. This new language of the people got a tremendous response, and the plays and songs of the KPAC were performed to large audiences all over the state. This is just an example of one of those songs, which was called the Harvest Song. The alternative nationalism from below that got reflected in musical terms through various interpretations of indigenous music was also accompanied by an internationalism that sought to establish connections between people across national boundaries. And they were bound by the desire to resist colonialism and to fight for social emancipation. So from the 1930s onwards, there had been increased interaction between theatre persons and musicians from India and outside India, resulting in translations of the well-known songs of the international cultural protest movement, such as the Internationale and La Marseillaise, into different languages. Hemango Biswas wrote songs about Paul Robeson and the Chinese Revolution, which had Western tunes. Bhupen Hazarika adapted Paul Robeson's Old Man River about the Mississippi to talk about the Lohi, Brahmaputra in Ahomia, and the Ganga in Bangla. However, it is the music of Salil Chaudhary that can be considered a major innovation within the IPTA tradition, marking a complete departure from existing music, even that which already existed in India's westernized tradition. The use of Western tunes as well as that of Western orchestration in predominantly Indian melodies was common in urban Bengal from the early 20th century. However, these innovations continued to retain the modal nature of the Indian musical tradition, where a basic melody uses a certain combination of notes, whether raga based or not. When Western orchestration was used with the main melody, what made it as pleasing or even more pleasing than the original melody was the exploration of harmonic notes in the orchestration, even though the instruments might explore notes not contained in the dominant melody. Salil Chaudhary's compositions for the IPTA, exemplified by Dheu Uche on the Naval Mutiny of 1946, moved away from the modal structure by using a series of modal melodies, each with its own given combination of notes and accompanied by harmonic orchestration, but such that each of the pieces of the song sounded very different from the other. He also introduced significant silences, varying speeds in the different sub-melodies, harmonies in singing, superimposition of one scale upon another, and other features which went on to become the hallmark of the Indian choir tradition, first in Calcutta and later on in Bombay and Madras. Writing about one of the popular songs, Gaayer Bodhu, that he wrote during the Bengal famine, Chaudhary noted, "The success of Gaayer Bodhu did a very wonderful thing. It heralded a new era in Bengali contemporary music. It was a completely unconventional song, having no traditional asthai and antara, and its movement from phrase to phrase was symphonic, in form with two distinct movements." Chaudhary was one of the greatest influences on the later urban folk tradition in Calcutta through his extensive use of the backup orchestra that set the stage for the emergence of band music. In his work, the orchestra achieved its much needed liberation, according to one writer, and along with the innovative use of percussion, he accorded the accompanying instruments the status of voices capable of making statements to qualify or modify those made by the human voice. The foregrounding of the orchestra was to become the ubiquitous feature of the musical arrangements of band music later. Apart from this, Salil Chaudhary's work was also characterized by his brilliant reworking and interpretation of traditional folk tunes to convey explosive political messages. In one of his most remembered early protest songs, Bichar Puti Tomar Bichar, a song against the brutality of the colonial courts, Chaudhary used a popular Bengali kirtan tune, traditionally devotional in character, and laced it with an explicit political text, transforming an old soft melody of devotion into a statement of explosive protest and anger. For him, the creation of the new aesthetic involved innovation not only in the poetic content of the composition, but also in form. This is Dheu Uche, which he wrote during the naval mutiny. Tradition's musical repertoire, wide in its range of styles, forms and languages, thus played an important role in creating a radical imaginary in the arts in India. I have argued that this imaginary was part of a radical impulse that unfolded in response to particular historical circumstances in the first half of the 20th century in different parts of the world, fueled by a politics of emancipatory humanism and the desire for socialism. Despite it being historically specific, I call this impulse radical because as part of it, pushing the boundaries of existing art forms became like a natural tendency and hence an impulse. Artists were not mimicking, neither was their art derived from external contexts. The impulse was driven by processes of art creation that were grounded in the international politics of the time and informed strongly by specific histories and traditions. I believe that a re-look at this tradition helps us to understand the relationship between music and politics and take it beyond its historical specificity in being an important constituent of the popular imaginary in music in India. An important constituent of voicing the popular by the IPTA's songwriters and musicians was cinema. The 1940s had seen the production of Dharti Ke Lal and Neecha Nagar as explicitly political films, but it was in the post-independence period that the IPTA's aesthetic was incorporated into popular cinema in different languages, with music playing a very important role. Music that was born out of the complex interface between tradition and modernity, mediated in interesting ways by emerging technologies like film. The ordinary figure persona was conveyed to mainstream audiences through a realistic acting format, punctuated with song and movement sequences that drew from particular performance traditions, and in many of these, the films that were produced, they were produced under commercial banners. Some of the songwriters and musicians from the IPTA tradition who were involved with commercial cinema were accused of being careerist and having sold out to commercial pressures. Often the songs that were written would have two versions, one for direct political use in meetings and campaigns, and another for the silver screen. Elements of strong social critique in the former would be toned down for the latter, ostensibly to create commercial acceptance. For example, Makhdoom Mohiuddin's Jaane Wale Sipahi Se Poocho was sung under the music direction of Salil Chaudhary by the singers Sabita Banerjee and Manna Day in Usne Kaha Tha, with the last stanza that contained a call for revolution omitted. In the original version, the last stanza went thus: Gir raha hai siyahi ka dera, ho raha hai meri jaan savera, ae watan chhod kar jaane wale, khul gaya inqilabi pharera, jaane wale sipahi se poocho, wo kahan ja raha hai. I believe that a significant part of the music from the IPTA tradition, both because of the astounding range that it contains, as well as the fact that it was produced at the crucial transitionary moment between colonialism and independence, continues to be relevant in our times. The IPTA was formed in the backdrop of famine and war, and it is hardly surprising that the songs written then are eminently suitable for interpretation and renewed performance in current situations of hunger and conflict. In the last 2 years or so, as debates on nation, nationalism and identity have erupted once again in India, and questions of Azadi have been debated, these songs, I believe, remain relevant in both political and aesthetic terms.